Good afternoon. Could we have the first slide? So, yes, I'm working with fungi. So, natural mold to sustainably improve biofuel production, not only biofuels, also biogas. So, and I work with these fungi for a precise reason. For that, I want to quote a colleague of mine who said, "We are all living in the gut of fungi." What does that mean? So fungi are all around us. So they are degrading all kinds of stuff, and especially they are living in forests. They are degrading the leaves on the ground. Everything that has to go into the carbon cycle can potentially be degraded by fungi. And many people don't know what fungi are doing all for us. So for example, if you had antibiotics treatment that saved your life, then most likely fungi saved your life. And I want to talk today about what they do for us in terms of biorefineries. So, of course, we have to leverage what fungi can degrade. So that can be very important for a future sustainable use of cellulosic resources. So, and that's where I'm coming from. So, this is the UFT. I'm here in Thun, very close to Vienna. And this area is the major agricultural area of Austria. So our aim is to understand the physiology of fungi. So because first you have to understand what your fungus is doing and what your organism is doing, why is it doing it, so that you can use that and improve that and optimize that for your purpose. So we want to understand signals, pathways, so something has to tell the fungus, you know, produce the enzymes that we want to do, because they are not doing that for us. They are doing that because they use it, because they need it in nature. And we want it too, so we have to know why are they doing this. So, and this is the challenge we are facing. So there is a lot of chemicals, a lot of products is made by oil. But that's not sustainable. As we heard this morning, we don't have four planets. That's just not going to happen. So we have to get alternatives. And one of these alternatives is using biomass. So you can use biomass, as we heard today as well, to burn biomass to get energy and to fuel that into a biofuel process. But you can also use biomass to produce chemicals, because enzymes that are degrading them, transforming biomass to chemicals, polymers, bioplastic. So that's very useful. But we also have to be careful, because this biomass also comes from food crops. Mm-hmm. And to make this whole process work, fungi are also important as microbial bioeffectors, so we can protect plants. So they can make the plants healthy, so we get a good amount of biomass without being in competition with food crops. And so for biofuels, the question is, yes, I have biomass and I have the fuel, but what happens in between? Where do fungi come in? So the biomass contains a lot of cellulose. But we want to have glucose. So here the fungi are important to break down the cellulose. And then from this glucose, Saccharomyces cerevisiae and other microbes can produce ethanol. And when we do that, we use enzymes because they have certain advantages. They have a low energy input, they are very efficient. The competition with food crops, direct use and land use has to be considered. But if we use community waste and cellulosic agricultural waste, then we have second generation biofuels that can contribute to a sustainable future. And the second part I mentioned is biocontrol using fungi. They are fighting pathogens. And even if there is no pathogen there, they are making the plant strong. They are helping with stress. So it's important to have a good microbiome in the soil to have strong and healthy plants. Also for the degradation of land, that's what I'm thinking about today in the morning, that if the degradation of land happens, then it's very likely that the microbiome decreased and got weaker. And that was not very much considered in the past because you just couldn't very well measure it. But now it becomes more and more important. So that pretty much summarizes what happens. You see palm trees in the rainforest, food crops, that's not what is sustainable for the future. But cellulosic waste to a certain extent, and agricultural waste, municipal waste, that can be used to recycle and not just to deposit it. And for that, it's also important to have organisms for which you don't have to think about, well, are they toxic if I put them back to nature? So you have to keep in mind, use fungi that do not harm. So in Brachyderma that we have is known as plant protection. So we are not so concerned about doing something harmful to nature. And what are enzymes, why are enzymes special? So they are large biological molecules. Their chemical reactions have mild conditions, very high reaction rates, and they are very specific, but of course you have to produce them first, so they are not like chemicals. And they are, again, all around us in our daily life, like in genes, apple juice, for example, is clear, these enzymes, and they are in detergent, so they are also around us all the time, and this is on the molecular level, some of the most important enzymes, it's a cellulase. So what happens is you have cellulose here, and the enzymes wind it up and just degrade it. And this was an enzyme of fungus, of Trachoderma riesii in this case, and it's known to be one of the best degraders of cellulose, also used a lot in industry. And therefore, as you can imagine, it's very well known. And the next question is, of course it's easier to degrade food crops. Because there is starch, it's easy to degrade, because that's storage. So the plant wants to store it and easily get this resource back. But that's also what we do, so that's what food is good for. But if we then want to degrade cellulose, like this, there is lignin around it, so that makes it harder to degrade. Then we have cellulose, we have hemicellulose, and these compounds are made to make the plant strong. They are not made to be degraded. So that's why for degradation of starch, you need, in natural terms, much less effort than to degrade cellulose. And that's also a problem for biofuel industry, because you need more of the enzymes and much more efficient enzymes to degrade cellulose than to degrade starch. That also means the comparison, even though a lot is already improved, is still not very favorable for cellulosic ethanol compared to corn ethanol. And there, I want to go in more detail with Trachoderma riesii, what we are doing here. So the industrial side is Trachoderma is a cell factory. So very much used, very versatile, and it does a great job for that. On the other side, there is agriculture. So species of Trachoderma are also helping us biofungicide, biofertilizers, helping in abiotic stress management and so on. So this is really a group of fungi that is very good for us. And what we are specifically looking at in my group is signal transduction. So why is this fungus doing what it does, and can we improve that? So what the fungus encounters in nature is things like light, like nutrients, competitors, and so on, and it senses them. And all of these sensations make the fungus produce more enzymes, less enzymes, metabolites, pheromones, and so on. And knowing what they are doing, we can shift that. And that's our aim. So that's a small scheme of what we already know at the molecular level. So what we want is to get the message to the promoters to make the genes work that we need. And then if we know how it works, the whole cascade, if the fungus sees, okay, there is the right nutrient, what happens until it switches on the right enzymes? So that's what we want to know, and on this way we want to remove bottlenecks. So if there is the right nutrient, but there is no enzyme, we are looking at why is this the case, and can we remove this bottleneck? And so this is a little bit more detailed picture. We have different influences that tell the fungus what to do. And this is a summary of what we already know. The funny or the fascinating thing is, you have nutrients here, so the fungus gets the signals from nutrients, but it also gets light signals. And when that comes together, there is an interesting decision, because the fungus doesn't produce the same light and darkness. But that's all on the molecular level, that's the industrial side, producing enzymes in industry. But what we thought about it, if you look at biorefinery in a forest or on a field, then it's out in nature. And so we thought we want to use natural fungi that come from the environment. And so we cannot play around with them. We have to understand them and modify them naturally. And therefore, we started collecting fungi in this area. I showed you before, so they were growing next door. And many of them, so it's now we have 300 strains, not too much, in terms of a strain collection you might know from other organizations. But we have 30 species of Trichoderma. That was quite a surprise. And the funny thing was, Trichoderma ricea, the industrial fungus I showed you, is from the tropics. So it's a tropical fungus, and we didn't expect that we find that next door. But there were 12 of these isolates were Trichoderma ricea. And I will show you now why this is so intriguing. And it's precisely that what happens here is two fungi meeting each other and then undergoing sexual development. So we found in 2009 that this is possible with the industrial fungus. So this was the first industrial fungus for which we could achieve sexual development, so crossing. You might know that from plants. So crossing of a fungus under laboratory conditions. And so what happens is they meet each other, they exchange the nuclei, and what comes out is like if we get children. So they are individuals, they have some characteristics from us, but they are still new progeny. They have characteristics from both parents. And that's a good thing. So here, fungi talking about a common future, what has to happen before is that they feel each other as well. So if you go out in nature, you cannot be sure that it will work. And yeah, that's what it looks like afterwards. So that's the fruiting body. So something like you know from mushrooms. So whenever you get a mushroom, then something like this has happened before, they had sex before. Then you get the mushroom. And you get everything that comes down is all new progeny. And that's the same here, just looks different. And in here, that's kind of a box where all the progeny are, and then they are shot out into nature and here on a plate. Yeah, what we also found out is if they are talking to each other, so this you can imagine is like two chambers talking to each other, that this communication has to work. And then if you think of nature, the fungus has to decide, do I degrade the material that's around me? And where do I orient my growth? Because the fungus has to move where it can grow best, or where it can reproduce best. And interestingly, it's not growing towards the food, but towards the plant. And it is growing towards each other. So that's funny that whenever a mating partner or a partner comes around, or there is blood, food is not interesting anymore. And so that's what we found. Like I said, next door, it's 12 different fungi that fortunately could cross. So we were very happy. And it didn't even take long. So for other fungi, it takes months. For Trichoderma, it's about 7 days. So we are very happy because we can use that for breeding, for improving a biorefinery process. And that's our aim. So we want to select suitable fungi that can very well degrade a natural substrate. And one part of it is Trichoderma ricea because it's good in degradation of cellulose and hemicellulose. And thinking about lignin, we also use viper fungi that can contribute to this whole process. And then Trichoderma ricea will be improved bisexual crossing, and then also selection, which one is doing best, what we need to do. And here, of course, if you put two functions together, they have to be able to live with each other. And Brachydomorrhizia is quite competitive, so what could happen is that Brachydomorrhizia degrades not only the substrate, but also the other fungus. So that's what we have to optimize by screening, selection, analytics, selecting the fungi, going back for another round of optimization. And ultimately what we want to have is a good combination that we can use. And of course, one thing is we don't want to have toxins in there, of course, that's another selection criteria.
And five minutes for you to just take care of.
Okay. It's almost the last slide. So we want to have a good combination, and of course we also want that Saccharomyces cerevisiae, whatever organisms comes afterwards, that can use the building blocks we are producing here, that they are not harmed. And of course that the product is clean and not dangerous. And here I show you the first step we already did. So the isolation, after the isolation, it was Samira who worked on that predominantly. We found that many of these natural fungi had quite a good efficiency. So this is an almost industrial fungus, because you don't get the industrial one. So this one is closed. That's a natural isolate. And those we isolated are not really so bad. So this is Semolaces, this is Xylomaces, and here they are also quite good. And then we did the crossing and selected several strains. And indeed, we had an improvement. So we selected the best ones. And yeah, this we have to check again, because this is too good to be true. So this is even more than 100-fold better than this early industrial mutant. But it tells us we are on the right way. So here we can really improve the fungi to be useful in biorefinery on a natural site, because these are natural fungi. We are not doing anything else than they do in nature, just that we do the selection and not nature does it. And it's fungi that are not dangerous, that are known to be plant beneficial. So we think we have a very good method here to do something with nature, to improve for biofuels that will benefit nature. So and with this, I want to say thank you for your attention, and I want to thank my students and my collaborators, and of course, the organization who financed the work.
Very much, a very well organized presentation. We have a huge number of figures which were very nice looking and also informative. So please ask at least something about those.
Thank you, Monica, for the constructive lecture, as we say. So I would like to know what's your recommendation in biorefineries. Would you prefer having the enzymes purified, or is it needed at all to sort of isolate them and use them? Or is it possible to make up all the hydrolysis by the actual mold strains, and what potential problems might come up by that kind of?
So the ultimate aim would be to use that part directly. Of course, at the moment there are enzymes being used, but they are quite expensive. So they are one reason why cellulosic ethanol is not competitive yet. So that's also one of our aims, that we do that in nature on the substrate without having to purchase the enzymes. What we have to work on is, of course, this fungus is degrading and eating up what it degrades. So we are trying to decrease that proportion and increase the amount of enzymes. So and if we can get that far enough, then it will be that you can use that directly. So that would be great if it would work that way.
Have you made any economic comparisons or calculations to compare between these two different approaches?
No, not yet. We are not far enough already to say, okay, we can make it work. so that you don't need to add 10 cells. But with this result that we could improve only with one crossing already that much, we are positive that in the end, this will be an approach that will work.
And this is a good example of how the information on the ecosystem function and on the microbiome can be really utilized for the industries. Thank you very much.
Thank you once more.